Have you ever thought of injecting molten filament into your 3D prints to increase their strength and stiffness? In this video, I will try out different approaches, from purging into negative volumes to reinforce specific areas, to automatically filling the whole infill using a custom G-code generator in Python. I will also test how this can improve mechanical properties and show you how to apply this technique at home. So let's get right into it, here at JanTec Engineering. Thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring part of this video. When 3D printing for technical applications, you often want your parts to be as strong as possible. While you could get a more advanced printer and engineering filaments, this comes with very high costs, making it inaccessible for most of us. I strongly believe that the next big steps in consumer 3D printing will come from software innovations and clever tricks rather than just better hardware and materials. That's why today I want to look into an interesting idea of using your 3D printer kind of like an injection molding machine by purging filament into the infill to increase strength. I have to be honest, this isn't my original idea. At FORMNEXT 2024, Steve from Steve Builds mentioned an exciting booth from AIM3D that I should check out. Unfortunately, I was short on time and missed it. A few months later, Stefan from CNC Kitchen featured AIM3D in his FORMNEXT recap. They developed a method called Voxelfill, which injects plastic into the infill to increase strength. Stefan also referenced an older research paper describing a similar technique. When I saw that, I knew I had to try it myself. And since this idea completely distracted me from focusing on the important things, I started experimenting. Disclaimer. This video shows independent experiments inspired by the general idea of injecting material into 3D printed parts for strength. It's not a copy of AIM3D's patented Voxelfill, just an educational exploration. The key concept is quite simple. In regular FDM printing, parts are built up layer by layer, but the connection between those layers creates a weak point most of the time. While the individual extrusion lines are quite strong, the bonds between them are relatively weak as they only partially fuse together. You can even see these tiny gaps, not just in theory, but under a microscope when inspecting printed parts. The idea is to purge molten filament into certain areas of the part, ideally filling these gaps and improving overall strength. A great way to demonstrate this is with a 3D pen. When you extrude filament in one spot, it forms a solid blob, showing how additional material can fuse the layers effectively. Thinking about this, without having read the paper or patent, I came up with a few different ways to implement this idea. The first approach is to create negative volumes in specific areas and filling them up. The second method, inspired by AIM3D, involves automatically filling gaps within the infill during printing. Lastly, instead of just using standard filament, one could also inject other materials like carbon fiber reinforced plastics to achieve unique mechanical properties. I'll walk you through all my experiments, tell you what I've learned over the past few months, and how you can use this method at home to make your parts stronger. I first started with a Prusa Mini simply because I had it at hand and know how the G-code for this machine works. To start, I added hollow cylinders as negative volumes to specific areas of the object to reinforce it. Before closing them, the printer moves to the center and purges just the right amount of filament to fill them up. The math for this is very easy. You just calculate the volume of the cylinder and divide it by the surface area of your filament. This gives you the amount you need to purge in order to fill the whole negative volume. Then you simply tell the printer to move to the XY position of the cylinder, purge the calculated amount of filament, and then continue printing. I did some tests and tuned the amount, speed, and temperature for the purging. Since it was very hard to see if and how the cylinders were filled up, I got myself a spool of transparent filament and modified my G-code slightly so that the printer would change the filament before and after the purge process. After a few stringy prints, some very strange prints, at around 2 in the morning, I finally got to a point I was happy with. If we inspect this part further, we can see that the printer is not able to fill the whole cylinder. That makes totally sense, since there's too little pressure and the filament cools and solidifies before reaching the bottom of the cylinder. This can be again demonstrated with a 3D pen. When kept at constant height, the purged filament knots and looks like the poop you might know from your Bambulab's AMS. So I guess that the strength does not really get improved at this point. To really fill up the whole volume and close the gaps, the nozzle must move into the part and fill it from the bottom up. This is of course not possible with a regular nozzle. When looking for a nozzle with bigger clearance, I found these and ordered two of them. They consist of an airbrush nozzle, which is threaded into the regular V6 nozzle, giving it a long and quite thin tip. Before we do some tests with the airbrush nozzle, I'd like to quickly introduce the sponsor of today's video, PCBWay. PCBWay is your go-to online manufacturing partner for custom PCBs, 3D printing, CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, and injection molding services. Whether you're working on a hobby project or a professional prototype, PCBWay has you covered with high-quality manufacturing and competitive pricing. Their online platform offers easy file uploads, instant quotes, and reliable shipping, making it effortless to bring your ideas to life. Visit PCBWay.com to learn more and turn your projects into reality. At first, I installed the nozzle in my Prusa Mini, but this didn't go so well as the extruder had problems pushing the filament through the nozzle and it leaked. After this first experience, I fully tightened the airbrush nozzle while heating it up. Therefore, I used such a bit from my screwdriver set that fitted surprisingly well. Then I switched to my Caribou MK3S since it comes with a direct drive extruder. Later, I also used my Prusa MK4. I only adjusted the pinder probe of the Caribou accordingly, but keep in mind that for more clearance, which will be important for bigger parts, it should be removed after leveling. I measured the tip of the nozzle to know how deep I could dive into the component. I came up with about 4 mm. The first test with a 4 mm deep cylinder went perfectly and the printer was able to fill up the whole volume. By the way, you can find some of my test G-codes, 3MF files and an Excel calculation sheet on my printables account, link in the video description. I did some more tests and adjusted speed and temperatures a little. You want to purge your filament as hot as possible to make it flow better. I had good experiences with such high speed PLA. I then also used this method to make test specimens using my Prusa MK4, we will test their strength later in the video. First, it was time for the next step, filling the whole infill. To simplify the calculations, I decided to start with grid infill at a 0° fill angle. Since it would be an absolute pain to calculate all the I times J positions and write a G-code for this, I decided to write a little function in Python. The function takes the position and size of the object displayed in the slicer, the grid size and current set height. It then calculates all points and the amount of filament that needs to be purged and writes it into the correct G-code format. The output G-code then simply needs to be copy-pasted from the terminal into this field, G-code before layer, and then the printer does everything automatically. At first, I tried this on the Mini with a regular 0.4 mm nozzle to see if the calculation works properly. Next, I did some tests on the Caribou and noticed that with bigger fill volumes, the thermal mass is too big and deforms the structure. That's why we want higher infill density and a few more perimeters. Then I added the option to dive into the infill to fill it properly from the bottom up, as described earlier. For my final parts, I installed the nozzle into my Prusa MK4 using the V6 adapter. The huge advantage is that the extruder uses the nozzle for the bed leveling, so there's no probe that could crash. By the way, this setup would be great for non-planar printing, but more on that in my next video. Now let's see if this method is actually able to increase strength. Since my tensile tester is still under construction, I will do impact resistance and bending stiffness only, at least for this video. As mentioned earlier, the key idea is to make the layer bonding better. That's why I decided to go with my notched impact resistance samples in standing orientation. This basically tests how well the layers fuse together. For the test, I 3D printed 3 regular samples from PLA with 100% infill and part cooling off, since the fan is not properly adjusted for the airbrush nozzle. Next, I added 2 negative cylinders in the slicer and created the corresponding G-code to fill them up. The print looks a bit messy, but for testing this is fine. The samples were dimensionally good enough to fit in my test rig. Here are the results. The filled sample had about 31% higher impact resistance than the regular sample with 100% infill. But please take this with a grain of salt, as there's always deviation. When inspecting the broken samples, you can see that the filling and bonding of the gaps work quite well. Next, I wanted to test the impact on stiffness. Therefore, I created three different bending bars. One with regular 100% infill, one with such a grid infill, and one with the grid infill but filled using the injection technique and the Python script. I printed the samples on my Prusa MK4 using PETG. Then I pulled out my 3-point bending test and measured the deformation of all three samples under different weights. While the filled version is about 18% stiffer than the regular infill version, the 100% infill is still stiffer. So at least with these settings, filling the infill could not really stiffen the part. But I think there are further tricks that could be worth trying out, like injecting other materials such as carbon fiber reinforced materials to stiffen the part more. Overall, injecting molten plastic into 3D printed parts to improve layer bonding is a fascinating concept with a lot of potential. However, as you've seen, it requires a deep understanding of print behavior and a lot of trial and error. Behind every successful example in this video, there were multiple failed prints and adjustments. I've already made some improvements to this approach, and I'm confident that it could be fully integrated into Prusa Slicer, even for more complex geometries. That's why I'm seriously considering a follow-up video, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. If you want to take a look at this idea in more detail, make sure to read the paper Z-pinning approach for 3D printing mechanically isotropic materials and check out my test files on printables. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe to not miss any future content.